that Proposition 30 passed, then there's a $6 billion hole in education funding in California. That's the reality of the situation. So we have to convince the voters in this area and across the state that we need to pass Proposition 30. If we don't pass it, we have to find ways of recovering $6 billion in the budget for education. Now, last year, the legislature cut $15 billion. And I think it's important to know where the state funding goes. The state budget is less by $10 billion this year than it was 6 years ago. It's been reduced by a considerable amount of money. And it mainly funds education. I always say this way, education, medication, which is health and human services, and incarceration. And guess which one has gone up the most? Incarceration. So what we have to do is we have to deal with controlling the cost in some of those other areas to get enough money to fund education. And that's basically what I'd like to do as a state senator. We have to stop the cost increase of criminal justice costs in our community.
Okay, that's thank you so much. So, next up,
the impact of the current budget challenges have been felt certainly in the classroom for quite some time, but even more so in the press in the last 2-3 years. What is needed right now is that Proposition 30 needs to pass. Because if that doesn't pass, I can assure you that many difficult decisions by the Board of Trustees will have to be made. And this will impact students directly. It would mean overcrowded classrooms, and believe me, right now, as a high school principal in just a year ago when I retired, believe me, the classrooms are already overcrowded. But I have to give credit to all of our teachers because they knew the difficulty that they are under. And yet they are not giving up. They are not giving up on your children, nor will they ever give up. Okay? So that is something, but however, we need to make sure that our students are receiving the quality education that they need. Now, if Proposition 30 does not pass, we are going to be in very great trouble. And I'm not saying that as a scare tactic. I believe that it will be the reality of the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Of course.
The impacts will certainly have hit our classrooms. But I think that with the leadership we have there now with Stephen Fisk and his staff, working very collaborative with the board, has made a tremendous effort to really give us hope. It is going to be tough if Prop 30 doesn't go through. I don't want to scare anybody, but that's the reality that we're facing right now. I have to tell you that I am so proud that he is there because he has chosen to come to the board and tell us, I am not filling this position of an assistant superintendent, I'm not filling this position of an assistant superintendent, I would like to bring in a director, bring it lower. He is starting at the top and not, you know, at the school sites. And I listen to him very carefully. He always informs me right away. And I feel that the impact that's been in Elam Rock has not really been as harsh as I thought it was going to be. It has been. But I feel that with his leadership and the collaboration that the board, on all the board working together with our unions, we're all working together to save what we can save. So, yes, the impact has been great.
Let me tell you, we did it. Some of you may remember that the foundation put up a lot of money to study what it takes to educate a child. Remember that one? They came up with an adequacy study. And they said, this is how much money it takes. This is how much money it takes to educate a child. And they recommended that for kids who had greatest needs, there ought to be higher levels of funding for those schools than in schools where the kids don't have the same needs as in those schools where the needs exist. And what they recommended, in essence, was that we redo how we fund public schools, and that it be based on the concept of need. Students that have more needs ought to get higher levels of funding. I introduced that legislation. The legislation got out of the Education Committee, and they said that that was the way that it ought to go, that we ought to fund schools that have the greatest needs at higher levels than others. Currently, what happens is what has already been said here. Palo Alto kids get $15,000 per child. Eastside gets $4,700, almost 2.5 times as much as they do at Alum Rock School District than at Eastside. Until we break that balance, we're always going to be struggling to provide the resources that are needed for our kids. You can't have a quality school system and compete in a global economy. You really can if you're 47th in the nation. You ought to vote for both propositions, 30 and 38. If you vote for 30, if we're lucky, we'll remain at 47th in the country. So you ought to vote for both of them. You ought to vote for education initiatives every time they come up, but you ought to pair those with some reform so we can change the way we do things. But clearly, there's got to be more resources for education.
Thank you. Leland.
I think the real impact, the immediate impact right now, my understanding is that for teachers are not getting any stipends for supplies in their classrooms right now. And I can tell you, my wife and other teachers pulls out quite a bit of money to supply the kids with materials. So that's no longer there. I know that the school sites are not receiving their funds, so we're having to go and ask parents for more money. You know, last year we had a homework session in the morning where a teacher was there to help kids with their homework. That's no longer there. Field trips. We're having to raise more money for field trips and many other, you know, things for kids. So there's a direct and immediate impact right now. Talking about Prop 30, what that means for Alum Rock, if Prop 30 doesn't pass, that's going to mean $500 million cut. Or I know, $5 million cut. What is it? It was $457 cut per child. So for that to happen, it's going to be totally devastating. So we need to do what we can to make sure that passes.
Thank you very much. Patricia.
As I stated earlier, Eastside has lost $51 million. Of course, it's been a tremendous impact. And don't vote for 38, vote for 30. Because we really need 30 to help us sustain the level that we have currently. And I'll tell you why. Just if you vote for anything, think about this. If you're a classroom teacher and you have more students in the classroom, you don't even have enough desks. You don't have enough materials. You don't have the staff. Eastside has lost counselors. We have 2 counselors for high school. We used to have 4. We have 24,000 students. We have 1 nurse. There was a proposal to cut safety monitors from our campus, and the board said, no, we don't want you to jeopardize our safety. So let's find a way to reinstate them. So we did. So you need to have a board that's going to understand budgets and how they work. Teachers have come up to the plate. Our classified staff everybody took a cut in Eastside. Everybody, even the board took a cut in their stipend. Why? Because we are committed to making sure that our students continue to get the education that they deserve. And of course, there's never going to be enough money to do what we want, but I think we've done very well considering we cut $51 million from our budget the last 4 years. Thank you.
Karen.
Yes. Well, it definitely has impacted our teachers, most definitely. They're doing more with less. It's impacted, obviously, our community because our crime is at an uprise. And we need to work together as one community to help make this change possible. But a few things with regards to the budget and how we can actually hopefully stabilize that within Allen-Roth would be, first of all, is that we stabilize and we have a superintendent who's able to stay. Especially superintendents who are doing a good job and have the ability to continue that. So I'd like to see some stability happen. And also to collaborate, again, as I mentioned, with our parents and our community so that we can work together to support our teachers with necessary needs that they may have. And I think the only way we're going to be able to do that is to be able to collaborate and have open dialogue and agree to disagree, but hopefully to always make sure that our children are at our first and foremost focus and how we can ultimately achieve that goal together. And so I'm hoping that we can actually work to do that.
Thank you. Esau.
Yes, we've been impacted by Sacramento, who have cut public schools year after year, and then what they owe us, they delayed and sent it to us. And so what are my plans in doing that? One, I'm going to vote yes on Proposition 30, Governor Brown's Proposition 30, to keep us where we're at so we won't sink further. And I'm voting yes on Molly Munger's Proposition 38, which sends money directly to schools. And I hope we have the good problem, nice problem to have, that both pass, or that one or the other pass. But to have them fight one against the other, bad, bad, bad. Vote for both. If you care for kids, vote for both. What else are we doing? Folks, one candidate for Allen Rock is unhappy. Unhappy that we have a lesser number of highly paid district office administrators. Yes, we do. We did have some administrators leave. And we're not filling those positions. Trustee Dolores Marquez and I provided leadership in saying, no, we're not going to fill these high paid management positions. But you know what we have? We still have small class sizes. You know what we have? We still have our award-winning Allen-Roth jazz band, our award-winning student mariachi band. One candidate for Allen-Roth said that she would cut our music program, our performing arts programs in that budget trench. Not me. We're going to direct our resources, as limited as they are, to our classroom teachers because our kids count. They're worth it.
Thank you.
Michael
Well, I don't know what I can say that's different from what all the candidates have expressed today. Have we been impacted by the budget crisis? Absolutely. We're not the only district that's going through this. There are several districts represented here. The entire state of California is having such a difficult time and really struggling. And I just want to make clear on a couple of things. When we talk about smaller classroom size, we're talking about laying off our most valuable assets, which are our teachers. We need to make sure that we keep our teachers in the classroom, teaching our kids, and making sure that they have manageable classroom sizes. When we talk about furloughs, we're talking about shortening the school year for our kids. So we need to be very, very in tune with what those code words mean, and that we're always at the negotiation table with our teachers and with our different unions to find the best answers and the best possible solutions for a humongous problem that we're all facing. Now, I'm going to throw in my little plug as well. Prop 30, if it doesn't pass, it means devastation to our schools. It means a $6 billion cut in education. And there was an article in today's Santa Mercury News that indicates that it is polling at under 50%. We need to make sure that we pass that. I'm not going to weigh in on 38, but I will weigh in on 39, which is closing the tax loophole for out-of-state corporations, and it needs to be closed. It will generate $1 billion in additional revenues, and a great portion of that will go right into the schools. 50% of that will go into green energy, jobs that cannot be transported or outsourced.
said, let's talk, let's meet, let's talk. We did. And I kept hearing from my community, so I voted to give them choices. Earlier, one of the ladies up here said, we have Safeway, we have Save Mart, we have different grocery stores. Well, in Elmont, we have public education, we have small schools, and we have charter schools. We are giving those choices. We have that in Elmont already. But what I agree with what people are saying up here is that we need a fair playing field. If charter schools have exemptions, I don't know why it's not amended or fixed up at the state level, where some public schools will have those kinds of exemptions that the charter schools have. The straitjacket type that was also said over here. Yeah, we need to get away from that. We need to be able to have flexibility, just like the charters. I'm sorry. Am I?
It's so bad mistake. It's
okay. I wasn't focused.
Gonna get him
and
dance next time. Joe, your turn.
Yes, I'm not going to repeat what everyone has said. I think it's already been said. Parents deserve choices. Charter schools provide options, and I believe that someone has already said that a parent ought to have the ability to decide where they want their youngster to be educated. If you want to go to Piedmont Hills, you ought to be able to do that. If you want to go to James Lake, you ought to be able to do that. allows you to become brighter academically when you utilize all of the skills that you have. So it has to be part of an education tool.
I absolutely support sports and the fine arts. They're very important. 4 years ago, Eastside was faced with a tremendous cut, and our former superintendent made a recommendation to eliminate some of our sports. And of course, it was a very difficult situation for our district. And we organized a fundraising committee, and I was the chair of that committee. And from that committee, a wonderful group of people came together and said, we're going to do something about it. They created the 5K run that we do every year at Mount Pleasant. So have we raised the money that we needed? Of course we haven't. But is it an important factor? Yes, it is. And do we need to have organized sports? We do. But the reality is that next year, if Prop 30 does not pass, we're going to have major cuts, major issues. We're talking about elimination of so many programs that I don't even want to think about it. So I'm urging you, please vote for 30. If you don't vote for anything else, vote for 30.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, I definitely believe that it's helpful and it's important, and it's been extremely a part of our family's life. As my husband and I were also helped to put together Eastside Wolfpack Football League, and we participated in that for almost over 10 years with our five boys. And also being in a local Flocorico dance group, which my two daughters and I are a part of. Music, arts, and athletic ability in our family is extremely important. However,
say, for the last 15 years as a trustee for Eastside, and 9 years in Alamar, and 38 years as a public school teacher at Franklin McKinley. So I've certainly, it's always been driven by the same thing, public service, helping others, making sure that they have equal access. And I'm not bankrolled by any charter school PACs, like some of the candidates up here. I'm self-funded, and I'm proud that I have endorsement from so many unions, and they have contributed to my campaign, but they're the working class. And I believe that I belong to the 99%. And that's a really important issue for me, because the majority of the students at Eastside are low income. We have a lot of homeless students that I'm working on that issue. We have a lot of social issues that are really affecting the education of our students. But we haven't talked about that. That's major, a major issue. So I'm very proud to be running again. I really would appreciate if you could continue to support me if you have in the past. And if you haven't, please call me or email me. Go to my website. I'm very easy to get a hold of. Call me. Would love to talk to you, because I want to convince you that I really am the best choice. This is not the time to change the guard at Eastside. We have a new superintendent. We have an amazing vision. We work very hard. We have a good board. We don't always agree on issues, but we do agree on one thing, that we need to take the district forward. So we're very excited. Thank you for this invitation.
Thank you. Karen.
Well, I'm a mom first and will always be. And so with that, I'm child focused. I have no political agenda. And a good leader sometimes is not always the most popular. But what I definitely will bring to this board is transparency, child focused, sense of urgency to ensure our children are not failed, and that we are able to collaborate with our community and incorporate parents and having a voice to ensure that our children are a part of a process that is going to succeed. And for the first time in 60 plus years, because our schools have been open for 60 plus years, is to ensure that they receive high quality education.
Thank you. Esau.
There is a local community organization comprised of Latino military veterans, of which I'm a member,